Okay, everybody here?
Okay, that's good.
Okay, I don't like to stand behind a lectern. I like to move around a little tiny bit. My name's Noel Ferguson. I sit on the steering group with my other colleagues at the University of Ulster on the, obviously, the Northern Ireland element of the retail and rural regions. But before I say anything about me or what we're doing, I want to find out a little bit about everybody in the room this afternoon. So I'm just going to ask a few questions. And you'll probably find that I'm not going to do so much of a presentation, but it's going to be more of a conversation. Okay? How many retailers do we have in the room? Can I have a show of hands if you're a retailer? Okay, all right. How many academics or members of the universities do we have in the room? Okay. Anybody who's neither of those? Okay, that's all the freeloaders in the room, obviously. I'm one of the freeloaders. this is very generously entitled a reasonable business consultant's experience. So I kind of had to think, do I actually have any experience? So just to kind of give you a bit of positioning of where I'm coming from in this presentation. Currently I'm with a company called Employee Intelligence. Some people say those two words can't go into the one sentence. But I would actually disagree. And what we look at is employee engagement and how you get an employee advantage as a company, how you get the most of your employees for competitive advantage. And we work with all sectors, but primarily at the moment we're working with retailers. And then this other little thing here called National Skills Academy for Retail. This is a government-funded organisation that tried to set up a network of what we call skill shops. Where retailers can specifically go and say, I need trained in retail in some particular element, and they would have a one-stop shop to acquire the skills that they need. Prior to that, I was involved in an organisation called Skill Smart Retail, and again, that's another government-funded or licensed organisation, which works with all of the retailers in the UK, and my role was looking after specifically the 9,000 retailers in Northern Ireland, and trying to get them to engage in skills development, etc. And prior to that, I was in an organisation called Learning Forward, and that was a town centre regeneration company. And that was working with around about 400 retailers from small to large organisations, and trying to create inward investment in a large town. And prior to that, a company called Royal Mail, which was essentially the post office within the UK. And if you think of the post office, it has lots of small post offices where you'll go, and it's a retail operation, and it's quite sizable. There was 170,000 employees in the United Kingdom. So in terms of a retail background, I've had quite a long journey, and I've been applying human resources and change management and organisational development interventions in those organisations. So I'm kind of bringing along that experience and looking at my views on how this project has worked within Northern Ireland, essentially. And what I want to have a look at over the next 20 minutes or so is try and shed some light on some of the problems which the project has faced. Yes, we've seen success stories this morning, but we have to bear in mind that whenever you do any post-project review, it isn't always successful. There are learning points and action points that we need to consider if we want to go through the project again, and also to ensure that the project is sustainable into the longer term. Consider some of the findings from Northern Ireland, some of the figures of the analysis which has come out of the Northern Ireland report. I think some of the learning points can be applied across all of the regions. Again, that's looking at the similarities in the other regions, and also thinking about actions for sustainability to ensure that the past 3 years' work continues into the longer term. Okay? But what I want to do first of all is a short video, and I want to pose a question during this video.
Well, do you get it from an old time? Thank you. Heaven watches between my head and heart. Till it ceases, I'll never know. How do you get up from an old time low?
That was a group called The Wanted, who had a song in the charts last year called How Do You Get Up From An All Time Low. And if anything, it struck to me as that could be the ideal theme tune for any retail, rural retailer. They're at an all-time low, the lyrics were ideal, they can't get any peace, don't know where to go, they're crying out for help, and hey presto, along comes the RRR project as the saviour. Everybody is bound to want to get involved in the rural retail project, aren't they? Now, where's the academics in the room again? Let me see. Okay, quite a few, alright. Hold on. Okay. How many of the academics in the room thought, you know, this is going to be so successful, they went out and spoke to the retailers, and all of a sudden, nobody wanted to get involved, and they all went, ah! Here's the solution, but not everybody's listening. Is that true? Did that happen? Yes? No? Yes? Oh, good. Okay, just, you're awake. Good. Right, okay. What you came up against was an awful lot of these things. All, everybody agree so far? Yep. How many see retailers doing this? Anybody? Yeah, quite a few. Yeah. Come along and talk to me. No, I don't want any of that, thanks. No. La. It can be very frustrating when you have the solution to something and that people are not willing to take on board that solution. And one of the things I want us to consider, if this is going to be sustainable, we need to understand why people didn't accept this project in the first place. In Northern Ireland particularly, we started working with 41. We have 6 who are going through on a really active basis at the end of it. We have about 125 or so across all of the regions that are actively engaged. What about all the other people who we first contacted and nothing's really happened to them? What I want us to think about is what prevented those people coming on board? Because it's really those people who need the help now. It's not the people in this room. The ones who aren't here need that help. And we're going to consider how we can actually get them on board. Not necessarily in the immediate future, but in the longer term as well. Okay. We've seen a few photographs there of some rural retail premises. And what I want to do is show you a picture of a Northern Ireland retailer. Metaphorically speaking, of course, this isn't, you know. There's an awful lot of similarities between this little doggy here and a retailer. And this is why. He has a furrowed brow. He's very tense, stressed out, doesn't know what to do, okay? He's got tired, saggy, baggy eyes from all of his sleepless nights, okay? They have their ears down, not listening to changing customer demands, even though they say they know their customers. They also have the eyes pointing downwards. They're not looking out into the long term. They're thinking about, what have I got to do today? Oh, I have to put the papers on the display stand. They had good times in the past, so they're actually quite plump and pudgy around the back end. And you can tell by his general shape and demeanour, he's very difficult to move. And we have to understand, he's at the all-time low, how do we get him to move? That's what we're going to have a look at. Does anybody know who this chap is? King Canute, yes. What did he try and do? He allegedly tried to hold back the tide. If whoever you look into the true Norwegian mythology, he didn't actually try to do that. However, he's the patron saint of retailers. In Northern Ireland, we have an organisation called NIRTA, which is the Northern Ireland Independent Retail Trade Association. And they're a policy organisation. And what tends to happen is that they would lobby on behalf of the small retailers. So any change in the environment, they will go to government and go, whoa, hold on, no, that's not going to work. You know, we'll keep the environment as it is, thanks very much. So therefore, the retailers think, well, we don't have to change because somebody's trying to hold back progress. So we don't need to change ourselves. But there's another way to look at King Canute, if everybody can read this or make this out. Discovery of the first anagram, Canute's a nutcase. And not kiss means he's not really thinking too straight. Okay? Now, what do we see on this sign? Show me what you see. Anyway, who can see this sign? What does it say? Future and past. Okay? All of the retailers who are not in this room, if they were to come in here and look at this sign, that's what they would see. That's where they want to go, that's where they want to stay. They don't want to move into the future. So what the RRR project needs to do, or have done, is to do this. Change their view to look at the future. Not at what has been, not at what is today, but what's going to happen in the future. Thinking back to Northern Ireland, and you have the United Kingdom, it's called the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, is the proper terminology. So Great Britain is Scotland, Wales and England. And what happened over the past 30, 40 years or so is that there's been a steady incline or growth in the market share of the large retailers, such that they have around about 75% of the market. And I would presume that everybody in this room knows the history of Northern Ireland and the troubled past that we've actually had. And because of that, investment really plateaued for 20, 30 years or so. And then all of a sudden, in 1986, we had major retailers who came in and bought up symbol groups, just bought up everything they could. So essentially, in a very short period of time, they had up to around about 3/4 of the market share in Northern Ireland as well. So in Northern Ireland particularly, it wasn't a changing tide of Northern Ireland retail. It was actually a tsunami wave of retail for the small retailer. And you can have a look here, there's a little doggy just on his wee boat. And what he's actually encountered is very, very quickly. He's in a mouth of a very big wave and he's got nowhere to go. So another way to look at this is that our little doggy is in a hole. Now, some people might think, well, he wants to get out of that hole. But maybe not, because there's actually a certain degree of safety to stay in that hole. And we have to figure out how we get the dog back out of that hole. Okay? Now, that's looking at the hole from the top. I want us to have a look at the hole from the side. This is a concept called the change curve, which may be useful or known to some people. And what tends to happen if a retailer or somebody has to go through a change, our little doggy's on the outside of the hole, he's quite happy, he's going along with the status quo. If any change comes along, he'll go, oh, that's not going to affect me. I haven't got a change, I don't have to do anything. And then all of a sudden what happens, he goes down the wee slide. And he ends up in a certain degree of disruption, he gets quite angry and he has to direct this attention or this energy somewhere. And my fear is that he goes to the likes of the policy organisations and says, look, help us out here, get this change to stop. I don't want to have to change myself, stop the change. Now what we have to get the retailers to do is not to try and change the environment, but we have to give them the skills to deal with the turbulent environment. So what we have to get this little doggy to do, Seamus, where's Seamus? You mentioned four words there. What was it, what were the again? Commitment?
Yeah, focus.
Commitment, focus, belief, and achieve. Right, that's what we have to do with the wee doggy. Get this wee dog back up the other side of this curve. So he's in that hole, and we need to get him out. And we have the solution to actually get him out of there. Now, anybody know who this chap is? This man, very few of us would trust with a knife and fork, but some would put him in charge of the American arsenal. Now, let me just go back here a sec. He didn't talk sense too frequently, but just have a listen to this.
The message there. The message is that there are known knowns. There are things we know that we know. There are known unknowns. That is to say, there are things that we now know we don't know. But there are also unknown unknowns. There are things we do not know we don't know. So when we do the best we can, and we pull all this information together, and we then say, well, that's basically what we see as the situation. That is really only the known knowns and the known unknowns.
Does that make sense? You know, a lot of people laugh at that chap, but I think that's the most sense he's spoken in about 5 years in office or whatever he was. And I'm going to explain actually why it made a lot of sense. He made reference chiefly to the two top elements of this matrix, the known unknowns, and the known knowns. And the Rural Retail Project tended to emphasise on those top two elements. We asked the retailers, what is it you don't know? And what is it you do know? And in order to get people to change, we need them to understand the things that they don't know and the things that they do know. So that's why an awful lot of retailers have not participated or haven't gone through the entire process. Now, to give you an example of some of the known unknowns, for instance, in terms of retailers, you can't necessarily understand what your competitors are going to do, and a lot of them actually use that as an excuse to say, well, I can't do anything until I know what, you know, the large supermarkets are going to do, for instance. There's no knowns. They say that they know what their customers want. Well, they don't really. And Eric's actually going to touch on that in his next presentation, where there's some retailers who say, I know what my customers want, but they don't. And there's proof to that. There's the unknown unknowns. This is the key to this whole thing. We've asked them, what do your customers want? Has any retailers actually gone out and asked non-customers why they're not coming into the shop in the first place? What skills will they need? We've asked them, what do you need? So if they actually attain the skills that they've lacked in the past 2-3 years, they're only going to reach the point of where they should be now, not where they should be in 2 or 3 years' time. They also don't understand how the sector will change. We've seen on that graph how all of a sudden, in the space of about 2 years, you know, 2/3 of their market share was eaten up by a large competitor. They need to understand what's going to happen, and only when they do that will they come on board and understand the need to change and get the will to change, and as Seamus pointed out, get that commitment to change. Peter Drucker came out with a lot of sensible things. It's quite futile to come up and try and guess what's going to happen in the future or what customers are going to want. But very often retailers will use that as an excuse to do nothing. Okay? They'd rather wait and see what happens. Does everybody remember the Sony Walkman? Yeah, little Sony Walkman, little tape deck. The market research indicated there was no market for that whatsoever. But yet, Sony went ahead, and I don't know if you actually know, I haven't got a pocket on at the moment, but it was originally designed to fit into the shirt pocket. Now, it was actually too large for a shirt pocket, so they got a special shirt made with a bigger pocket and put it in, and everybody thought, oh hey, that's handy, we'll go for one of those. So what you have to do is come up with your concept or your strategy for your shop and just go for it. If it goes downhill, then at least you have come up with a strategy and you have made the decision. You haven't waited for somebody else to make a decision first and then you follow along behind them. What we need, the retailers in this room particularly, you have acquired a new set of skills, okay? Where you probably were whenever the project came out to you and asked what skills do you need, you were in a state of what's called conscious incompetence. You knew where your skills were lacking, you knew what you wanted to change, and you said, yes, thanks very much, I'll have some training and development in the particular areas that I need. The retailers who didn't participate are probably sitting down here, unconscious incompetence. They don't know what skills they're lacking. They think that if they continue to do the same thing day in, day out, they will continue to survive. They're not going to thrive. Survive, maybe. Now, the retailers in this room particularly, as you apply your new skills, you're going to move towards conscious competence. You're going to get very smart in the application of the new knowledge that you have. And eventually, you're going to come down, come down to here, of unconscious competence. What you do will become automatic to you. Now, the new retailers who are acquiring these skills, you are the key to sustainability of this project. You will have fellow colleagues in retail shops who you need to go out and have a talk to and say, you know, this was actually very useful and this is why you need to take these skills on board. The people who aren't here, an old Arabic proverb, answer not the fool in his error for thine attempts to instruct him will arouse his hatred. So all those people who are coming along with their fingers in their ears, they didn't want to be told that they didn't have the right skills. So therefore, the thing that we need to do, as I say, is show them how their environment is going to change. And then they will understand the need to acquire the new skills. Some of the findings which came out in terms of Northern Ireland, some of the incidental findings, is there around with the trends and the self-employment trends in the sector of retail. Now, there's been a bit of research carried out in the UK over the past 10 years or so, which has looked at all of the sectors, and it indicates, obviously, the percentage of people in self-employment in the sector. On the behalf of retail and distribution, it started off about 10 years ago with sitting around about 13-14%. And we can actually see there are fewer and fewer people who are self-employed in retail and distribution. The market is on the way out. Only by applying your new skills are you going to turn that around. Now, one of the other findings that came out in Northern Ireland was the lack of skills amongst self-employed or small rural retailers. Now, this looks at all of the sectors in terms of what's known as the third level qualifications, anybody with a degree or higher in that particular sector. You can actually see the people in retail and distribution, it's amongst practically the lowest. I mean, I'm not picking on you, Seamus, but you were saying you practically went into the business at the school, no qualifications. And I think people see retail as an easy route, okay? Yes, it's something that you can do or start with minimal skills, but you still need to acquire new skills to sustain that business. And another finding, which is there, is that the percentage of people in retail with no qualifications is amongst the highest, other than agriculture and forestry. So that's another reason why those other people haven't come on board. It could be a fear of actually wanting to engage in the process of skills development because they feel uncomfortable with it. They don't see the value of it or don't necessarily see the need of it. Now, retailers, particularly as we say in Northern Ireland, they have been dealt a knockout blow over the past 10, 15 years or so. And what we need to do is to help to get those people back up again. And you're going to do that today, okay? What's this? That's a microphone. Guess who's going to be using the microphone now? People in the room. I'm going to teach you a new word. I think it's Japanese. Has anybody heard the term karaoke? Yeah? Okay. Don't worry, I'm not going to pick on any one individual. Everybody in the room is going to take part in a karaoke at this next moment, okay? Just bear with me a wee second. Now, there was a group called Chumbawamba in the UK, and they came up with a song called Tub Thumping. And basically, it's about an individual who drinks to forget the present and not have to think about the future and always harks back to the past. And the main lyrics in this song are, I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never going to keep me down. And that is the mantra that we need to pass on to the rural retailers in all of the regions who have participated in this project. Now, the way we're going to do it is quite simple. I am going to sing the I get knocked down. And whenever I point to a table, you then have to jump up and sing the next line. Okay? So, it's going to be simple to start with. You're going to be singing, but I get up again, this table, okay? And next table will do, you're never going to keep me down. And then I'll go, I get knocked down. And you do the next line, and so on, and so on. So get ready to jump when I point at the table, okay? Now it has to be loud, and it has to be vocal, okay? Now we're kind of in country tables, so we want to see which country is the loudest, okay? We'll just say one thing first of all, okay? Only when I point.
I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never going to keep me down.
Said we're going to do a karaoke. How many of you actually sat there and thought, there's no way I'm getting up and doing a karaoke? Who did? Put your hand up if you said it. If you really thought that. Right, okay. Who thought, oh, maybe go along with this, it might be all right. Okay. Who by the end of it thought, I guess this isn't bad crack, we'll all jump up and down for a wee bit. Yeah? That was not a wasted exercise. What you have just gone through is the change curve. So how many people at the thought, no, I'm not doing that, this isn't happening really, I can't believe this guy's going to get me to sing. And then you thought, I've got to get up, I'm getting disrupted, I want to sit here and have an easy afternoon. And by the end of it, you were starting to accept it, and by the end of it, even those people who weren't taking part, they find a commitment. And you know what? It's those people who we need to get involved on the periphery who aren't engaged. So to summarise, first of all, we need to figure out where each retailer is if we're going to shift them along a change process such as the RRR project. And in conclusion, the key points I wanted to leave with you this afternoon. Don't just ask the retailer what they need. Show them what they need. Okay? Help them to identify the unknown knowns and the unknown unknowns. The unknown unknowns are very difficult, but all you can do is be mindful that there are things in the environment that you will not know about and you can't influence, and they could come and knock you sideways at a moment's notice. Understand that change curve particularly. You've just gone through it. Your retailers go through that every time there's a change in the environment or any time somebody presents something new to them. Understand therefore what changes or what creates that reluctance to change and engage. The future will not be turbulent free, okay? Retailers can expect policy organisations to hold back the advance of the large multinationals. They have to react to the environment. Same way as that little dog on the boat. I mean, he can sit and say a prayer, you know, to God and think, please God, don't let that big wave hit me. But the thing to do is to be prepared for the wave to hit them. It's not necessarily about giving the right answers by saying, here's the skills you need. It's about asking the right questions, back to the knowns and the unknowns, etc. And that the conclusions come to the retailer come to the conclusion based on your guidance. Just don't go out and say, this is what you need. Show them what's going to happen, and gradually they will come on board and understand that and accept that. Now, that's where I want to leave it. My presentation has changed slightly from what could be on the USB. If you have the slide on your USB, there's instructions to go to the website and you can download the full version. You can have the karaoke as well if you want to have it in the office or whatever and jump up and down how we sing. But there'll be a stripped down version as well there. And thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.